Okay, fine. Hello. Good evening. Let's get started. Welcome back to the Advanced Machine Learning lecture series. Just to recap what we did last time, we started discussing Bayes, so the formula of Bayes to update our knowledge of the world. Maybe I quickly go through that again to set the stage. We want to ask questions like, if we have made an observation that is a measurement, what's the most plausible explanation? Also, how should I update my knowledge about the world once I made this observation? How much new information have I obtained? And we saw that there are interesting questions in this regard where you have to worry both about the intrinsic probability of a certain explanation, as well as the probability that the observation is compatible with the explanation. And then all of this is nicely resolved by actually the mathematics of Bayes' formula, which is very easy actually, once you know conditional probabilities. And so it tells us how we get the updated probability of a certain model or explanation given the observation. And the formula is shown here. We basically have the inverted order where we ask about the probability of an observation given the model, and what enters also is the intrinsic probability of the model. Now, there are a few names for these pieces that enter Bayes' formula. What I call the intrinsic probability of a certain model, that would be the prior distribution. And then what is the probability of the observation given, we assume the model to be correct, that is the likelihood of the observation. And then finally, the result of Bayes' formula is our updated knowledge, that's the posterior distribution. So what's the probability of the model given the observation? And so you can apply this immediately also to slightly more complicated settings, like a sequence of observations. And typically you would assume if the model is fixed, then the sequence of observations is independent. However, each of these likelihoods depends on the model, of course, and you just need to multiply the probabilities. And sometimes it's convenient to look at the logarithm because the logarithm of a product is the sum of the logarithms. And in any case, what this promises to give you is the more observations you do, the more the likelihoods for different models will be different, and the more you can pinpoint which model is really underlying reality. And then we went through two physics examples, qubit measurement and cavity decay. Both of them are quite illuminating how you update your model distribution. This led us to the concept of conditional entropy, which is basically what's the entropy after you've done the observation and you still average over all possible observations. And what you see is that on average over all possible outcomes of the observation, this entropy is reduced as compared to the entropy before the observation, which makes a lot of sense. So you learn something, the distribution, at least in this average sense, becomes more narrow, becomes more focused. And so that can then be used to define an information gain. That's just how much on average the entropy is reduced. Okay. And so last time we then finished by saying something about the wider context of how to apply this. So instead of just looking at a very specific model where lambda stands for, say, a single number, like the number of photons in a cavity that is unknown to us and which we try to find out, we could also say much more ambitiously that lambda is all possible models of the world. And so that might be the different models that could describe planetary motion. And there's maybe a discrete set of such models, plus in each model, we also have some continuous parameters. That emphasizes the fact that it will be very difficult to have a prior distribution over such models, very obviously. And there is no unique good answer, but one can make some plausible guesses that lead to plausible results. And then the outcome in any case will be that whenever you make an observation, you get a little bit more certain, at least on average, you get a little bit more certain about the model lambda. And so I called it here to pinpoint the model and to have really something graphically in mind. Let me draw a picture. Imagine that you have your overall model space. Here it's drawn in 2D. And then you make your first observation. And let's say that already focuses your model space onto a smaller subset of all possible models. Then you make another observation. And on its own, this observation would be compatible with all models in this circle that I just drew. But of course, both observations together pinpoint towards the intersection. And so you go on with further observations and you can see, and here it gets more difficult, but you can see that eventually you filter out a lot of the models and eventually maybe you end up with a model somewhere here in the intersection, and then you can make that even more precise with further observations. And so not surprisingly, when people apply Bayes in practical examples like high energy physics or cosmology, you often also find plots of this nature where, say, different measurements would prefer different models, and then you're going to look for the intersection. Okay, so this is a rough outline of how we would like to understand the world via Bayes, but that's of course more long-term vision and not so easily implemented. Now, all of this rests obviously on the prior. This is somehow the problematic part in a lot of the discussions. It was easy enough for our physics models because it would just express our existing knowledge about, say, the state of the qubit before we do any measurement. And we could say, well, we are very uncertain. It's 50% in one state and 50% in the other state. So that's still relatively easy. But once we go towards such more complicated settings, it becomes complicated. And the question is then, how much is the influence of the prior on Bayes? And that's, of course, a question that people have been asking for a long time. It's also a little bit a criticism of Bayes, because that's the one point where something subjective may enter and where different people may start with a different prior. And if they start with a different prior, they might come to different conclusions. And so the point I want to make now in this little section is that if you make sufficiently many measurements, then you become a little bit independent of the prior, to some degree at least. And so different people with different prior would still converge towards the same predictions. And so that is called the consistency of the Bayes approach. So let's see, what do we mean by that? Let me imagine that my model space is really one-dimensional, so lambda is one number. Let me also imagine that I have a prior that is maybe looking like a Gaussian, to keep it simple. So that's my prior. It has a certain width, so I already acknowledge that I am uncertain about the value of lambda. But to be a little bit nasty, we will now assume that the true value of lambda actually lies quite far outside. So, in a sense, there is a true value, an underlying reality, but we don't know it. We, the observer, have a very broad prior, and the prior is even shifted away from the true value. Okay. So the simplest question you can ask in this setting is, once we make more and more and more observations, do we converge in some sense towards the true value? And if the answer is essentially yes, then you can ask, well, how long does it take to go there? And of course, you could ask these questions for any kind of prior distribution and any kind of likelihood function, and any kind of actual true value. But in order to be able to calculate anything in this example, I want to take the simplest toy model. And that's essentially working only with Gaussian probability distributions. So that means for me, we have a Gaussian prior to start with. So that would be, let's say, centered around zero. That's maybe just my definition of zero. It's the center position of the prior and with a width W. Okay. Now, in addition, I have to tell you what is the likelihood function. So given a model, given lambda, what's the probability to observe a certain value of my measurement? And again, I will assume this is a Gaussian. But now I have to make it interesting. The center of this Gaussian for Y will depend on lambda, of course. Different models should lead to different observations. Otherwise, I will never be able to distinguish the different models. And so I simply assume that Y on average is shifted by lambda. So that's a linear relation between the average of Y and the underlying model lambda. And then I say, well, Y also has some noise, and that's expressed by sigma. So if you want, I could say what I've just written in terms of a probability density. I can also write in another manner. I can say, aha, Y equals lambda plus noise. So this is one of the simplest assumptions you can make. And so we have Gaussians, and we have this linear dependence between Y and lambda, and it cannot get simpler. And so the question is, what happens in this kind of model? And I first want to discuss this qualitatively. We will just make a sketch, and then we will go through the calculation, because it's a nice calculation to practice Bayes and to practice Gaussian distributions. So how does this evolve? Here's lambda, and I started out with my prior. Okay. And now I make the first observation. And of course, this first observation, Y, will typically be at far to the right, because that's where my true value is. And so what this will actually do is it will shift the whole Gaussian also to the right. So I get something like this. And then I make the next observation, and the same kind of thing happens again. I should note that this is a bit stochastic, of course, because each measurement has noise, but this tendency, as we will see in a moment, is very strong. I go towards the correct true value. And let me just point out the true value again. Let's say it's sitting here. And then I can go through this procedure many, many, many times. I don't draw all of this, but eventually I will hopefully converge to a distribution that is very much centered around the true value of lambda. And then if I go on with my measurements, I just pinpoint it more and more. So the width of this probability distribution shrinks. So in a nutshell, this is what's going on when you make more and more observations and apply Bayes to this problem. So I can say this is after two observations, and so on and so on. Okay, fine. So this sounds plausible, but of course, unless you make the calculation, you shouldn't believe it. And so let's do the calculation, actually. Let's apply Bayes to this problem. So we can say, what does Bayes tell us? What is the probability of lambda given the sequence of observations? Well, we know already I have to multiply the likelihoods for each of these observations and multiply also with the prior. I write this tilde sign to mean proportional to, because of course there's the normalization factor that sits in the denominator that comes always with Bayes, but we will not need it. We just know automatically this will be a normalized distribution. We could work out the normalization factor, but we will not be interested in. What we will be interested in first is what type is this distribution? And we will immediately see it's still a Gaussian distribution even after you do the Bayes update. And then second, what is the average? What's the new center position? And third, what is the width of the new distribution? And since everything that we multiply is a Gaussian, and we multiply a lot of things, it's smart to take the logarithm of everything. So logarithm of P of lambda given Y. So as a shortcut, I will put Y in curly brackets, meaning the whole sequence. Well, and what do we get? We have the logarithm of the prior, which is just the thing in the exponent, plus some extra term, but this extra term that comes from the normalization of the prior does not depend on lambda, so I will neglect it. It will only go in the overall constant that is responsible for normalization and which we do not need to discuss now. Okay, so that's the prior. And then there is the sequence of observations of likelihoods, each of which has 1/2 sigma squared and then yj minus lambda squared. I just wrote that on the slide previously and I have to sum over all of them. So this is the product turned into a sum via the logarithm. And then as I just said, there would still be a constant, but this is independent of lambda. So it's just good for normalization. Okay, fine. So that's the first step. And now what do we do? As I said, we want the new width and we want the new center position. So in order to get the new width, you always need to look at the term that multiplies the square of lambda. So I will say I have something like lambda squared. There will be another piece here, obviously, but okay, there's a square of lambda. And I have to read off what is the prefactor for the square of lambda. And I will call that, I will simply define that as 1/WN², because that will be the new width. Now, this formula still will be completed, but we can already read off what is this 1/WN² that is the width after N measurements. Well, I just pick all the terms that go like lambda squared. So there is one term that goes like 1/W², that's the first term. And then there are all these other terms, each of which goes like 1/σ², and there are n of them. So I would have this. And so the first question you need to ask is, does this formula make sense? That is an important question you always need to ask in mathematics. Does it make sense? So the inverse squared of the width increases, because if n goes, it gets larger, obviously this increases. Does that make sense? Well, yes. If the inverse of the square of the width increases, then the width decreases. And we would hope that by observations, the width decreases. So that's good. That's what we need. Okay. So that means Wn decreases. And we can read off exactly how this goes, and we can make a plot in a moment, but okay, let's go one step at a time. Now, this is the lambda squared term. We still want to know, where is the new center position for lambda for the distribution after these n measurements? Well, what you do is obviously you look at all the lambda terms, the linear terms in the expression above in the first line, and you set up the second line such that you would reproduce the correct linear and lambda term. And if you think about it a little bit, the linear and lambda terms are only coming from these terms here. So it's always yj times lambda, something like this. And so here I thought a little bit about it. So what you need is the following, and we can confirm it in a moment. Let me just be smarter. Let me say this is the new lambda bar n after n steps, and we can try to read off lambda bar n. Well, you see these terms here that are linear in lambda, they do not contain Wn squared. So also if I take the second line expression and calculate the linear in lambda terms, I should not have anything depending on Wn squared. But there is, of course, already this expression in front, so I have to undo it, and I need something that cancels it in the numerator. Then also I see in the first line, everything goes like 1/σ², so I need the same thing here. And then finally, each and every one of these lambda times yj terms, contributes a yj, so to speak. And there are n of them, so I have to sum over all of them. Now you could still worry that a 2 is missing or something, but if you look carefully at these two lines and compare them, you see that is actually the correct expression. Okay, and we will check it again later that it makes sense. And then finally, there would of course be terms that are neither lambda squared nor lambda, so I can pull them all into the constant, which again, I'm not so interested in. Fine, so we now know how the width of my base distribution changes via the updates, and I know how the average looks like. And I want to point out one thing. The width evolves completely deterministically in this model, at least. So I can predict how Wn decreases with n. The average position, definite mistake here. So the average position depends on all the yj, the observations, and they of course fluctuate. There is some noise. So I will be able to calculate an average of this over all possible observations. But in principle, this is still a fluctuating quantity. And that's usual in Bayes. Since your observations are stochastic, also your updates are stochastic. So you cannot expect that after 3 steps, every observer in every run of the experiment will have exactly the same Bayes distribution. That's simply not true. Okay, good. So let's sketch. Okay, let me still mention this is stochastic. Let's sketch these things a little bit. First, let's sketch how the width evolves. So that would be the width versus observation number. And these are the questions you can ask, not only for this toy model, but quite in general, for any kind of sequence of observations when you treat them according to Bayes. And so what you see here is, well, you can just work it out yourself, but it of course decreases. The question is how it decreases with n. And at first there's just a linear slope. And if I didn't make a mistake in my calculation, you would have something like this. And that I think was in the limit if sigma is much larger than w. That's an interesting assumption. We have to discuss it for a moment. If sigma, which was my measurement uncertainty, is much larger than the prior, what this means is that my measurement is very weak. I don't learn very much for each measurement. And then there is such a regime initially where I very slowly decrease the overall width. You can also analyze the other limit where sigma is much less than w, then immediately I will make a big jump in the Bayes update. Okay. What's even more interesting is how does this evolve when I go to large n, large number of observations. And there you can work it out yourself. The width is no longer even dependent on the width of the prior, in this limit at least. And it goes like sigma divided by square root of n. And so that's the typical behavior. If I make many observations and average over them, the uncertainty of the resulting estimate of an underlying parameter that I get by averaging over the observations, this uncertainty goes down like 1/√ of n. So I get more and more information, but this is unfortunately a slowly converging factor. So in order to get 10 times better precision, I need 100 times more observations. And if you've done any experiments in physics, you probably know this unfortunate effect. Okay, so that's the width. But the question is, what about lambda? That is the center position. So we now confirm that the width decreases just like I sketched it here initially. But does the center position actually converge to lambda star? And so let's look at it. As I just told you before, unfortunately, the center position that I called lambda bar n, the center position is stochastic. It depends on my observations. So there's two things here. First, it fluctuates. Okay, that's one thing. But the second equally important thing is these observations, they are drawn from the true value, because up to now, nothing in this calculation depended yet on the true value, if you noticed this. So there was the prior, there was the likelihood, but nothing depended on the true value lambda star. If it remained like that, we would have no chance that we converge towards the true value. So the yj, the values of the yj, which are drawn, of course, according to the true underlying real distribution, that's the place where lambda star enters. So now we will discuss how the center evolves. And the most important observation is what I just said. The YL are drawn from the real distribution, the true one. So what this means is, on average, YL will be equal to lambda star. And so that means the average of the sum of YL is just n times lambda star. And so that helps me now, because what it means is if I look at lambda bar, the center position, we saw it's Wn squared divided by sigma squared and then the sum. And so what I can say now is that even though in principle it depends on the stochastic outcomes of the measurements, I can say, at least I know it's average. Its average is this prefactor times n times lambda star. And so I leave away the fluctuations. So I could say this is a good approximation up to fluctuations in the sense that every random variable I could say is equal to its average plus fluctuations. And the hope is that if n is large enough, this average piece will dominate and the fluctuations will be quite small. Okay. And so now we have this expression. It contains lambda star. That's a good start. The question is, how does it look like? Well, we again have to distinguish the short times and the long times. So let's talk about a few measurements only, which means sigma squared. So what does it mean to have few measurements? That means sigma squared is much larger than w squared n. So that's a condition. And then what I would have is just wn squared is in this limit still equal to w squared. And I would have this. And so what I see is I'm going away from zero. Remember, the prior distribution was centered at zero. Now I'm increasing in the direction of lambda star, in the direction of the true value. And again, this is what I tried to sketch here. So there's this strong pull of the distribution towards the true value. And then finally, what is the limit for n tending to infinity? Well, then wn squared, we had it somewhere, wn squared in the limit of n tending to infinity just goes like sigma divided by what the square root of n. And so if I insert this here, sigma squared divided by n, this cancels the n, and I just get lambda squared. And of course, that's very nice. This is somehow what we hoped for. I get a more and more narrow distribution centered better and better around lambda star. Yeah. And so again, if I want to sketch the situation here against the number of observations, that would be the place where lambda star. I start from zero because that's where my prior was centered. Was my definition, so to speak. And then I will be pulled towards lambda star and eventually I will converge. And in case you're interested, this difference here goes down like 1 over n. Okay. Good. So, yeah, these are the two things. Maybe we want to mention them. Again, so first we converge. And we converge no matter how large w or how small w and how wrong the prior was. Okay, that's of course a little bit of a lie. At least it's true for all the Gaussian priors that I investigated here. It would not be true, that's a remark that I'll say in a moment, when the prior has exactly zero probability density at the true value. That's a pathological case. And we can also ask, how many steps do we need to come close? And by close, I mean that lambda has a distance, say, less than epsilon, less than some epsilon from lambda star. And I try to work it out for you. What we find is that I need a number of steps that scales in the following manner. Lambda star divided by W, sigma squared divided by W epsilon. Now let's have a brief look at this formula. First, if lambda star was very large as compared to the width of the prior, then of course I need many, many steps to escape the wrong conclusions that my prior suggests to me. So I need many steps. Okay. And then the second thing is, if sigma is very large, I also need many steps, because sigma was the uncertainty in my measurement. And if sigma is very large, each measurement doesn't give me much information. And then finally, of course, if epsilon is small, so I demand to come very close to my true value lambda star, I also need many steps. So all of these things make a lot of sense. But I think there's a question. Very good question. Could it be that base updating does not necessarily update to the true value for distributions like if, for example, the likelihood is a Lorentzian? From what I know, if I interpret the mathematical literature correctly, even then you should go towards the correct value, but you need to be very careful. In Gaussian distributions, I can be very sloppy. I can just say, where's the center? And that's the same as the average and so on. And everything is fine and nice. If you go towards distributions where you even have to be careful to calculate a mean, then of course, what you do not want to do is to try to calculate the mean and try to prove that it goes towards lambda star. So I'll tell in a moment what's the actual mathematical statement. And I think that also works if you have a Lorentzian. But mentioning the Lorentzian, the Cauchy distribution, is also important in another way that I mention in a moment, namely the number of steps you need. But very smart question. So it's true that some of these remarks do depend on my choice of example. So one thing I still want to note is the following. This lambda star divided by W, this was the central factor that entered the number of steps that I need. I could also write in the following manner. If you tell me what was the prior Gaussian distribution probability density evaluated at lambda star, far out in the tails, so to speak. Let's see where this is, far out in the tails here. If you tell me this value and I want to calculate lambda star divided by W, I have to take the logarithm, minus the logarithm. And so what I find is that this factor that determines the number of steps I need goes like the logarithm of the probability density. So what this means is I can have an exponentially suppressed prior and still converge relatively rapidly in a decent number of steps. So for example, I could have something like the prior at the true value being something exponentially small, but the number of steps I need just scales like the exponent and not in any other way. Yeah, I don't need 10 to the 10 steps, I just need 10 steps or something like that. So that's very good. The other thing is, we also see from these considerations that different observers, so to speak, that start from different prior distributions may approach lambda star from different sides in a different way at a different speed, but eventually they will all converge. And now finally, another note, and that's related to your remark, and I wanted to do this. If the measurement, if the likelihood P of Y given lambda would have fat tails like a Cauchy distribution, so for example, P of Y given lambda is something like Y minus lambda squared plus sigma squared and the inverse of that, so Cauchy distribution. Everything that I said could be much worse. In the sense, it would be much, much slower. And the reason is very simple to understand. So the reason is, if your prior is still this Gaussian that falls off exponentially, but your observations have these fat tails and can have a lot of noise, even relatively large values of the noise, then they do not help very much to push your distribution into the proper direction. Yeah, they are very weak as compared to this Gaussian. So your prior knowledge will dominate, and you take much, much longer. And then even this discussion of, we are, in a sense, even for an exponentially small prior, we just need a decent small number of steps, that would not be correct. Okay. But coming back to your question now, this was, of course, an example, and I already made the remark that some aspects may not be generalizable. The question is, what do the mathematicians tell us? And so if you're interested in this, I'm not going to discuss detailed mathematics here, but if you're interested in it, there are two theorems that you would want to read about. One already from 1949, and the other from the 60s. And so what they established is what is called the consistency of Bayes. So they have in mind the same situation, but now generally you start with some quite arbitrary prior, you know there's a true value, you do observations, you make the Bayes update. Question is, do you converge? And essentially, I'm now paraphrasing the mathematical theorems. Essentially, if the probability density of the prior is non-zero at the true value, and that's of course very important, if your prior says no, this can never be true, then also Bayes will tend not to converge. But if it is non-zero and smooth and so on, then with probability one, so meaning almost always, as the mathematicians say, we know that the Bayes distribution, given the observations, starts to concentrate around the true lambda star. For n turning to infinity. So what we mean by concentrate is very simple to depict. Here's the true lambda star. I draw a little box around lambda star, and I know that eventually practically all of my probability density will be found inside this small interval. And if you make the interval smaller, then of course I have to just make more observations, but I still will reach the same situation. So that's the first thing. And there's the second thing where I can say that if I have, again, a smooth and so on, function of lambda under the right conditions, and lambda goes like, is distributed according to the Bayes updated distribution, then under the right conditions, this also goes to G of lambda star. And you might ask then, but I wouldn't be able to give the answer here, if I try G of lambda equals lambda, and I apply this to the Cauchy case, where do the assumptions fail, possibly? But the first one that we concentrate around lambda star, that's independent of whether I have Cauchy or some other funny distribution. Okay, so these are the theorems. This is what the mathematicians tell us. Of course, they don't tell us how fast this goes. And so all the additional analysis we had been able to make for the Gaussian model, that you would have to do case by case. Okay. So any questions about this? But the bottom line is Bayes has some form of consistency. And that's good. So if people start out with different prior knowledge of the world and they make observations, or they make the same kinds of observations, then they will converge towards the same updated knowledge of the world. So is it possible to obtain these results using central limit theorem? And now, central limit theorem does come into play in some of the analysis, but I fear this analysis is much more complicated than simply central limit theorem. So in case any of you are mathematicians, it seems, or so I have read, that what enters here is the theory of martingales. I don't even know how to pronounce this properly, but you may want to spend a moment to find that. And so this is basically random processes that fulfill a certain characteristic, something like generalized random walks, and which are very useful in this context. But I don't claim to know more about this. Okay, good. So then let's move on to another very, very interesting chapter of practical interest. And that is, we want to apply Bayes to something more complicated. We always had this, say, one parameter. It was either discrete, like the state of the qubit or the photon number for the cavity, or maybe it was continuous, like this one-dimensional variable lambda that I used to illustrate things just a moment ago. But let's make it more ambitious. Let's say, if we think of scientific discovery, that my model for which lambda stands is represented not by a number, but by a function. Yeah, this happens often. For example, this function could represent a force law, the force as a function of distance. And I have to distinguish between different force laws using my measurements. So that's the idea. So lambda equals a function from now on. And so basically I want to have a situation where maybe here I have, and typically I will call it phi of x, yeah, just to be clear. And so I could have a situation where I have several possible functions. So this is one function, that's another function, this is a function that is also possible, and that's yet another function. And so there are all these candidate functions, and maybe each of them has a prior probability. We will define in a moment how this is done mathematically. But now I make an observation. So I observe the true function at some position x. I say, the true function has this value at this particular x. And so then the question is, which of these functions is closest? And of course, I would say, probably it's this one. But there may be many, many others, of course, as well. And then you make further and further observations, and you shrink the family of curves that are consistent with these observations more and more. Okay. Now, if I have a function and talk about a probability distribution over functions, that whole thing has a name. And we are talking about then random processes or random fields. So what is a random process? It's just a random function. And it's called process because what you have in mind is something that depends on time t. So a fluctuating process. If you talk of a more complicated function, let's say is a function of two or more dimensions, then you would rather call it a field, but it's the same concept. Okay. Now, the notation is always a little bit tricky, because if I write phi of t, you might think that I refer to the particular value of phi at this particular t. And maybe that's not what I want. So to make this clearer, one could say I consider the phi of t at arbitrary t. Sometimes people write it like this. Or I could say I consider a phi, and I know it depends on a variable, but I will not write down the value of this variable to indicate that I mean the whole function. Okay, but that's a minor detail, not the value at a particular t. Now, how do we talk about the probability of functions? This is more complicated than before. Well, what you can do is you bring it back to what we discussed before. So you can just say, well, let me pick a finite number of points, time points. Let me look at the values that my function takes at these time points. And let me take those values to be random variables. So we could then talk about those by specifying a joint probability density. So I would talk about P of phi of T1, phi of T2, and so on. And I want to specify this for any set of time points and any number of time points. Okay, and if I've done that, if I can do this for arbitrary numbers of time points, I have basically specified completely the statistical properties of my random field. Now, there are some consistency conditions that are obvious. Namely, if I write down the probability density of just two values, phi of T1 and phi of T2, I should get the same thing as if I specify it for three values and integrate over one of them. So things like the following will hold. Okay, but that is kind of obvious. You would have assumed this. Now, these are random processes or random fields, and they can look very complicated and not very smooth. And I drew one example where I have this piecewise constant function that jumps around. But a particularly nice set of random processes or fields that we can analyze nicely are, you can guess it, Gaussian random fields. Which just means that this joint probability density is always Gaussian. So it's a multivariate Gaussian distribution depending on these multiple values at the different time points. And so often I like to think of it on a finite lattice, a discrete lattice, that makes thinking of it easier. Because then I'm back to our usual old multivariate Gaussian distribution. So what I think of is something like this. Maybe behind it is indeed some smooth function that is a Gaussian random process. But what I'm interested in is only the values on a grid. And so on, yeah. And this grid, I could imagine, has some spacing A, if that is of any importance, and I will have n grid points. And this is what we will be doing when we then numerically analyze these things. And if that is true, then of course I can write down explicitly the Gaussian probability density for all of these points together. So let us do this. P of phi 1, that's the first grid point, phi 2, and so on until phi n, equals, and now I will write it once in all its glory. So obviously it's a Gaussian, so there must be an exponential, minus 1/2, this much is clear, we always need this. And then I want something that has a certain average, and this average I will call phi bar. So phi bar j is just what I should get out if I use the probability density and average. And just like for a standard one-dimensional Gaussian, what I need to write down is basically phi, that is now the vector of all components, phi 1, phi 2, and so on, minus phi bar. And that should enter in a quadratic fashion, so it enters twice. But since it's a vector, I will take it to the transpose, and in the space in between, there will be a matrix that tells me what is the variance. And that is just our covariance matrix that we already introduced when we discussed PCA. Well, it's rather the inverse of the covariance matrix, comparing the usual Gaussian where you have 1 over sigma squared. Now we have 1 over C, the covariance matrix. And then since I promised to write everything, I will also write the normalization factor this once. So I would have square root. And now typically in one dimension, you know, there's 2 pi times sigma squared. Here I get 2 pi to the power of n because they're n variables. And then instead of sigma squared, I actually have the determinant of this covariance matrix. Okay, so this is it. Now, what's the covariance matrix again? We already discussed it once, but we can define it again just to be sure. CLJ is just the correlation matrix, so to speak. Phi minus phi bar index L, phi minus phi bar index J, and then averaged according to this probability distribution that I wrote. Okay. And we can also, just like we did before for the PCA analysis, we can say that the deviation from phi bar is my fluctuation vector. And then I would say, aha, this is delta phi L times delta phi j. Okay. Mm-hmm. So the question is whether I should show this. Maybe not. Maybe we can maybe leave this for the homework. If you want to prove that given this probability density above, indeed, if you calculate the covariance matrix, you will recover what I wrote down below. That is not immediately obvious. And if you want to prove this, that's 3 lines or so of algebra, and you have to be a little bit smart. But maybe we can defer that to the homework. Okay, so just believe me, or this is also what you find in every textbook on multivariate Gaussian distributions. So now what do we want to do with it? Back to the story. We want to do Bayes. We want to say we take a measurement, we measure one of those phi at some position, at some time point, and then based on this measurement outcome, I want to update my Gaussian distribution. So I will have a measurement at position, and now we are on a discrete lattice. So I say at position j with some outcome yj. You're used to that notation so far. So what I expect, of course, before I go into details is if at j I measure yj with some noise, then afterwards, if I have updated correctly my distribution over functions, afterwards, all these functions hopefully go through the same point that I have observed. Something like this might be obtained if I sample from my distribution over functions after I implement Bayes. So let's see whether that happens. Okay. So I still need to specify my likelihood function. So what's the observation process? And of course, I again will make my life simple. I will say, well, the probability that I observe yj given my function phi is just a one-dimensional Gaussian. I could make more complicated models of the measurement, but Gaussian is good because that will help me that the update also produces a Gaussian again. And so I will say this is now a one-dimensional Gaussian because I measure phi only at position j. So I will have something like e to the minus 1/2 yj minus phi j squared divided by sigma squared, where sigma is the uncertainty. And then I can also write down the normalization. So that's the measurement uncertainty. Okay, good. And so now I can just straightforwardly apply Bayes, no matter the fact that I now am dealing with a much more complicated model space, namely all these curves. So I would say P of phi given yj, my observation, equals P of yj given phi times P of phi. Divided by the normalization, which is, of course, we remember, is just P of having this observation independently of the model. Okay, but we never need the normalization because we can always renormalize the probability density. Now, what sits in the numerator? This is important, yes? So the likelihood times the prior. And let me do the same trick that I did before, that I only worry about the logarithm and I don't worry ever about terms that are independent of the phi. So all these normalization constants, I will drop them because I know that it will be normalized in the end correctly. So I ask, what is the logarithm of my updated distribution? And again, that's some constants that I don't care about, plus terms that come from the prior and terms that come from the observation. So maybe first the observation. The observation I've written above, so that's minus 1/2 yj minus phi j squared divided by sigma squared. Okay. And then there is, of course, the there's the exponent from my Gaussian distribution. So I have to write down that as well, which was, if we remember, minus 1/2 phi minus phi bar transpose C inverse phi minus phi bar. Okay. So now what do we do? Basically, we play the same game as we already did when we talked about the consistency of Bayes. And the game is collecting the terms that are quadratic in phi and the terms that are linear in phi. And the game is called completing the square. So I want to write down everything in terms of something like phi minus a new phi bar times a new inverse of a new covariance matrix. So that should be the kind of expression. Okay. But to make my life simpler, I will write now everything in terms of delta phi. Remember, delta phi is basically phi minus phi bar. That makes my life simpler because the second part is then immediately delta phi. And so if I want to rewrite this, I would say I have the constant, and then I have the part from the observation. Now I need to be careful because I rewrote everything in terms of delta phi. So I have to say, this is yj minus the average minus delta phi. And the rest is simple. Well, simple is relative. It's still an expression involving a matrix. And so now, so now we need to collect terms. And the first thing we will do again is to collect all the terms that are quadratic in delta phi, because they will teach me what is the new covariance matrix. So let me collect all the terms that are quadratic in delta phi. And then there will, of course, be linear terms in delta phi. I can already identify them now. So before I write down the C prime, I will immediately identify the linear terms, and then we come back to C prime. So the linear terms, they are, I think I wrote them down, yj minus phi bar j delta phi j divided by sigma squared. And then there will be other terms that do not depend on delta phi, so I can combine them inside my constant that I don't care about. But now, what is C prime, the inverse? Well, there are two pieces to this, and that's important. So C prime inverse must reproduce the C inverse, of course, but it also must reproduce any quadratic terms that are coming from the first term here, from the observation. And so let's do that. And I claim these quadratic terms coming from the observation, they of course are only relevant at j. So that's delta phi j squared. Yeah? So from this delta phi j squared divided by sigma squared term, I find that the inverse matrix, and now I really write it down in terms of indices, is the old inverse matrix plus a little extra piece, which is just 1 over sigma squared times something that only will give me a contribution when both n and m are equals to j, because that's exactly what I need. If I sandwich the C prime inverse between the delta phi vectors, it's exactly the term that I will need in order to reproduce what I wrote up here. Yeah? And so I need a Kronecker delta nj and a Kronecker delta mj. So this is all I need. This is the change, the modification of my covariance matrix, because I implemented a measurement, and this measurement, at least in the vicinity of the measurement, will of course shrink the variance. Yeah? It will shrink the noise in the curves. This is what we immediately see up here in the plot. Okay, so that's the first piece. And then what I still want is that I combine all the quadratic terms, which are the ones in front, together with the linear terms, which are the ones in back, in order to get an expression that looks exactly in form similar to this standard expression that we started out with. Because once I have achieved this, I'm done. I can say, aha, my update has just given a new covariance matrix and a new phi bar. And then I can proceed with arbitrary many updates. So that's the idea. Okay. And so let me call this whole expression maybe star. And I will find that star equals some constant, of course, even another one. And then hopefully minus 1/2 delta phi minus, okay, now how to write it? Maybe I say delta phi bar. It's a funny notation, but you will see in a moment. C prime to the inverse and delta phi minus delta phi bar. Okay. And so what's this delta phi bar that I introduced? This is exactly the term I need in order to correctly reproduce the terms that are linear in delta phi. So it's basically this term, but to make it work, I have to multiply this term with C prime. And why is this? Because it will still be multiplied by the inverse and has to reproduce the correct term. So basically delta phi bar is C prime times another vector that I can call B, and the B is simply that exactly the term that I need. So yj minus phi bar j divided by sigma squared. So it's a little bit of calculation. Maybe you should go through it by hand again. But if you do it like this and take the expression here and just see what are the linear, what are, if you multiply everything, what are the linear terms, then you will find that indeed you reproduce what you needed. So let us summarize the whole story, because that is important for us. Let us summarize. So P of phi given the observation is a new Gaussian multivariate probability distribution with the following. C prime inverse is C inverse plus, now I'm trying a notation that you may or may not like, JJ. So this is a notation borrowed from quantum mechanics, but what this simply means is J is a vector such that its component L is just the Kronecker delta. Yeah. And so this is the same thing that I said before, only said in different words. And that's also true for the left part of the vector. Okay. So this is one piece. And then phi bar prime, the new phi bar, so to speak, is phi bar plus C prime times J, that's the position of the measurement, times yj minus phi bar j over sigma squared. That's so to speak how far the measurement at this point deviates from the expected value that I expected according to my prior. Okay. So it was a little bit of a lengthy calculation, but it's good to see it once. And it's very powerful now, because we can now take arbitrary Gaussian processes defined by an arbitrary covariance matrix, and we can then apply measurements that have a arbitrary uncertainty sigma. And we can also repeat this multiple times, because you see this procedure can be repeated. Now I get my new covariance matrix and my new phi bar, and I can then recursively apply the same procedure. Just after the next update, I will have a different J on the right-hand side. I will have a different measurement outcome on the right-hand side, YJ, and I will insert on the right-hand side my already updated covariance matrix and my already updated phi bar. So I can apply it again and again. Okay. Good. So is there a question so far? So we will now go to have a look at this, a few examples. that will make it clearer, but maybe there is already a question here. Yes. So each measurement J just modifies a single column in a single row. Okay. Well, it's a little bit tricky. It's true that in terms of the inverse covariance matrix, the measurement only modifies one single entry actually in this inverse covariance matrix. But if you calculate the covariance matrix itself, of course, you have to take the inverse of this. So suddenly all the elements are affected. And then for the phi bar, you see there is this piece where you multiply J, which is a very simple vector that only has a single non-zero element, but you multiply onto it the matrix C prime, which is this covariance matrix that has entries basically everywhere. And so suddenly you affect many more elements than you would think. And that is also seen in my sketch here. So in this sketch up here, you see that once I have made an observation at a single point, the variance of these curves, so the spread in a sense, the spread becomes smaller in this vicinity of the observation. And also the curve itself, as you will see in the numerical examples, is affected everywhere. So there are quite non-local effects, even though the formulas look quite simple. Okay, so let's move on to discuss a little bit some examples that will make it clearer. So one of the things one can look at is translationally invariant covariance matrices. This is something that we briefly discussed before. So if the CLJ is actually only dependent on the difference, you still have to decide how it looks like. And it could, for example, look like this with a typical length scale, let's call it Xi. And then if you do this, what happens if you draw a typical function out of all those processes, you would have something like this, where the typical correlation length is Xi. So this would be just one of many different random samples. And we will see more in a moment. Now, before I go to the actual numerics, I want to make an interesting analytically tractable limit. And that's basically the limit where I try to have a very simple form for the Gaussian distribution. So let's just write down an example. So I want to say P of phi, and now I go back at first, at least to the random process defined on a continuous time coordinate. And I will say this, that it's proportional, P of phi is proportional to e to the minus, some constant I don't care so much about, and then an integral over dt, d phi over dt squared. Okay. So how do I even understand this? Well, I always can understand it by going back to the lattice and saying, well, on a lattice, this sum over t could be written as something like sum over j, and then an approximation to the derivative. So something like phi j minus phi j minus 1 divided by delta t squared, and then there's another delta t from the dt of the integral. So that's an approximation. So I approximated both the integral and the derivative. And then that is something I can work with. And you see it's quadratic in phi, so it must be possible to express it in terms of what we wrote down with this kind of matrix. And so I will find that this expression I can see, apart from the 1 over delta t, of course, I can say that this expression is, I have to be careful here. Yes, so it's phi, the vector phi transpose, and then a matrix, and then phi. And the matrix, if you work it out for yourself, has twos on the diagonal and minus one on the off diagonal. And the rest is zero. So the rest is all zero. Okay. So this is the matrix that you get if you convert this, what seemed like a continuous expression, into finite differences, and then eventually into a matrix. And this is exactly the kind of matrix we need. So apart from the prefactors, this is our inverse correlation matrix. Okay. And so then, so this defines at least precisely what this analytical expression means. If you were a little bit worried about having these integrals, but it's still useful to keep this integral expression because we can manipulate it in many ways that are a little bit easier maybe than working with matrices. So one of the things I can do with such a analytical expression is I can say, let me integrate this by parts. And let me assume that there are no boundary terms. And then I will find, this is the same as phi and then the second derivative. Yeah. So you see, this happens when I integrate by parts and there are no boundary terms. And that can be quite useful in a moment. So let's now assume that I have done a measurement, so the usual situation in Bayes, or maybe even done multiple measurements. So I would say P of phi, given all my measurements, so the value at time zero was y zero, and the value at time one was y one, and so on. And I would say, according to Bayes, I know apart from normalization, what I should get is minus 1/2 k integral d phi dt squared dt minus 1/2 sigma squared, and then a sum over all L, the differences between the values from my phi and the values from the observations. So that's just Bayes applied again, but now to this kind of expression. And now we see something interesting here. These, let us discuss the different terms. These terms, obviously, what they would like to have, if I ask how can they be minimized in order to maximize the probability density, well, what these terms want to have is that the phi of TL is as close as possible to the observation YL. That is natural. But then what does this term do here? Well, this term punishes gradients, yeah? It doesn't want to have large d phi over dt. And so the question is then, what is the balance? What is the compromise between these two terms? And we can do this mathematically. So we will just now say, I want to find the most likely phi after I have this probability density. So I want to find in a Gaussian distribution, the most likely phi is also the average phi. So we want to find the phi bar of t for the posterior, that is the distribution that I just wrote down. And how do we find this? Well, we just we maximize the exponent, or we take the minimum of the negative of the exponent. And so you can always do that. So I want to say now, and now there's a little bit of, say, slightly more advanced mathematics, and it's nice for those of you who have, say, already done some physics and, for example, derived Lagrange equations of motion. For the others, I always suggest to go back to the lattice version, and then everything becomes easy anyway. But it's slightly more elegant if I do it on continuous time. So what I would say, I take the functional derivative of the exponent with respect to phi of t, and I want to set this to zero. Yeah, that's finding the extremum as usual. Now, what's the functional derivative? This first piece with the d phi over dt squared, I have already told you that I can integrate by parts and rewrite it in this manner. And then you can imagine that you replace each of the two pieces phi by some given phi plus delta phi, and you only keep the terms that are linear in delta phi, and you demand that overall this vanishes. So this is how we take functional derivatives. But anyway, if you then finally do it, what you will find is k times the second time derivative of phi at t. So this is the functional derivative coming from the first part here. And then you have still something from the second part, and this will give you minus one over sigma squared, sum over all observations, delta of t minus tl, and then this difference. And all of that should be zero. Okay. Now that may look complicated to you, but it's actually not very complicated. If you are not at any of the measurement points, then of course the delta functions in the second term will make everything vanish. And what I am left with is that the second derivative of phi should be zero. But I know how to solve this. This just means phi is a straight line. So if there's no curvature, phi is a straight line. Okay, so that was easy. What happens at t equals tl? Well, then the second derivative is equal to some delta function. And at least those of you who have already, say, learned something about elementary quantum mechanics have encountered similar problems before. Or if you have done electromagnetism and some scattering problems, you have encountered similar problems before. And what it means if the second derivative is equal to a delta function is that the first derivative has a jump. And the size of the jump will just be determined by exactly this term here. Okay. So now, if the first derivative jumps, that means I have kinks in my straight lines. And so what I then expect, and we will confirm this numerically in a moment, is the following. If you tell me that I have observed my function at a few points, so this is time, and this is the value of phi, and these are the observation points, so the y1 and y2. If you tell me this, and I want to calculate what is the average phi bar after I update according to Bayes, I will just see something like this. I will see a straight line, and then there's a sudden kink where it changes direction. And again, there's a sudden kink where it changes direction. So you will see exactly this kind of behavior. That's, remember, that's only the average phi. Yeah, so that's where the probability density would have its maximum. Of course, if you draw random phi from the distribution, you get something that looks more complicated as usual. Yeah, so you can get many different curves, but they will all fluctuate around this kind of average phi. And so what this average means is that, at least on average, Bayes update for the simple Gaussian random processes is a kind of interpolation. So you interpolate through the observed points. And so now, just in the last 2 minutes or so of today, I want to show you numerical examples, and then you get a chance to go through these numerical examples in the homework. So the first numerical example is exactly what I now discussed. So assume that your probability density is essentially given by punishing the curvature. So the gradient d phi over dt squared sits inside the exponent. It turns out if you haven't done any observations, you get the behavior that is depicted here. And I produced a few random samples of phi that are compatible with this probability density. And if you analyze it closer, you will find these are actually random walks. So one of the most famous random processes, these are random walks. Now, I should also say, by the way, that I added a little term here so that the overall fluctuations of the values of phi would be constrained within a reasonable range. If I did not do that and I literally took only a punishment for the gradient, then the values of phi could be all over the place, and I don't like to have this. Okay. Now we do a first measurement, and it's depicted here. And what then happens is you immediately pinpoint everything to this value of the first measurement. So the average, which is always depicted in black, so that's phi bar. This average immediately jumps to the value given by the measurement. And also I've tried to indicate not only a sample of different curves, but I also indicated the spread of phi at any given point. And you see that the spread becomes smaller near the observation, just like anticipated. At the observation, you have become quite certain about how things should be. And essentially, the width at this point is related to the width of the measurement sigma. And then we can go on. That's now the nice thing. We can have two measurements, and this is shown down here. We can have two measurements, and just as promised, you get a linear straight line interpolation between these measurements. And we can have three measurements, and again, you get a linear straight line interpolation. You also see that the straight line does not necessarily go through the measurement points. That's important because on the one hand, you want to go through the measurement points. On the other hand, you want to be as close as possible overall to a line with a small gradient. And so you make a compromise in the end. This compromise would go away when the sigma becomes very small, then the black line, that is phi bar, really tries to go exactly through the measurement points, which are the red points. Okay, so this is the case where I punish gradients. And now you can go on in just the last minute. What happens, for example, if I punish the curvature? Yeah, if I punish the curvature. So instead of gradient squared, I have the curvature, the second derivative squared. And then what you see is that the curves that you generate are much smoother than what we had before for the random walk. And also if you now make observations and you look at the curve, the phi bar curve that goes, that tries to go through the observation points, this is another kind of interpolation. It's no longer linear interpolation with straight lines and segments, but it's an interpolation that is known as spline type interpolation. So of course, this was invented already in a completely different context that has nothing to do with random processes. If you just ask yourself, if I want to make a nice smooth interpolation without any kinks, maybe I should not use straight lines, maybe I should use something like third order polynomials, and this is what these are. Okay, so that was a lot of material, but I hope it became a little bit clear. These Gaussian random processes are really powerful. That's the message. Well, any questions for today? Well, I don't see any urgent questions right now. So tomorrow we hope to put up the exercise, and there will be a little notebook that teaches you how to do these Gaussian random processes, and you can play around with those yourself and generate many samples of curves that try to go through observation points. So I think that is quite helpful. Okay, so see you next time. See you on Monday.